Hi, I'm Philip Bisola, and I'm a faculty member at MIT in EECS. And I study computer vision and machine learning in robotics. And I'm happy to answer some questions about those topics today. So let's go to the first question. Okay, what is embodied intelligence? Embodied intelligence is the study of AI systems that have to interact in a physical world, in the real world. So think robotics. But the study of embodied intelligence is really encompasses a lot of different fields. So we need to be able to perceive the 3D world around us. That's a vision problem. We need to be able to take actions and make decisions. So these are problems in decision making and robotics. So embodied intelligence is a very kind of holistic take on the AI problem. Let's go to the next question. Can you tell me about your contributions to the field of computer vision? Specifically, could you detail some of your key work in applying machine learning to image processing? My work has been on a few different topics, but one of the central themes has been on trying to understand how should we represent the world around us, and specifically, how should we represent the visual world around us? There's a lot of different answers to that question, and you know, one answer might be you could have 3D models of objects, and you could have the geometry represented, and you could have like the semantics represented. For example, I would know there's a cat in the photo or a dog in the photo. My work has been on a slightly different direction, which is let's not kind of pre-specify or hand engineer the way of representing the visual world, but let's let it emerge from a learning algorithm. And I've specifically worked on using deep neural networks to learn visual representations from data, where the representation that's learned is what's called a neural embedding. It's what the neural net has come up with as a way of organizing the data that it sees. And in particular, I've worked a lot, my group has worked a lot on an approach which is called self-supervised learning. So in this approach, you don't teach the neural network from kind of human-specified labels, but instead you train the network to try to predict properties of the raw data itself. So for example, you could take an image and you could mask out half of the pixels in the image and try to predict the missing pixels from the pixels that are observed. So this is something that you can train on just raw data without having any labels or humans specifying what, you know, the representation should be. But the neural net learns how to make these predictions, and by doing so, it comes up with a representation of the world which knows something about objects and continuity. Like it knows that if I have, you know, the left half of the table here, there's probably a right half of the table on the other side. This idea that just by predicting missing data, missing visual information, you will get a representation which knows how the world works. And that's a representation that can be used to make meaningful predictions about the future. For example, what will happen if I open this door? What will I see? What will happen if I drive my car forward? Will I go through a red light? If I can make these predictions, I can make good decisions, and that's the type of visual representation that I've worked on. Any advice on how to tell the difference between AI-generated images and natural images? Okay, this is a hard one because I can't tell anymore. We're just at a point in history where if I see a photo online, I don't know if it's real or if it's fake. And that wasn't true a few years ago. This is very much a new thing. The main way that I would try to assess if an image or media online is real or fake is not going to be by looking at artifacts or the visual content. It'll be, you know, looking at the context. If there is some kind of crazy implausible photo of some celebrity on Mars, I'm going to think it's probably fake. If I don't trust the source, if it's an anonymous source, I might not trust it. That's the state that we're in right now. Luckily, there are some technical tools that can help. So there are AI systems that have been trained to detect if a photo or some kind of content is made by another AI or if it's real, authentic content. And those sort of work. We're in an arms race where the generative AI methods get better and better at making realistic synthetic content, and the detectors get better and better at detecting any little artifact that gives away that the image or the content is not real. And it's going to go back and forth. That arms race is not going to have necessarily a clear winner, but we'll see what happens over the next few years. Ultimately, I would say I trust media when I trust its source. I can't verify just with my eyes anymore whether or not an image is real or fake. Okay, let's go to the next question. Could you explain to me what deep nets are and the kinds of representations that they learn. So deep nets are, you know, super cool. They're the big thing in AI that everyone uses now. Deep nets are basically just a class of functions that can be used to make decisions or learn representations of the world. And they're a class of functions which are modeled off of how the brain works to some degree. So in our brain, we have a neural network, a real neural network, and a deep net is kind of an approximation to that. It turns out that deep nets are really a simple class of function in a certain sense. They're just a stack of layers, and every layer takes the input data at the bottom of the stack, and it kind of transforms it. And layer by layer, the data gets processed and transformed until at the top of the network, you get a better kind of representation of the data that can be used to make predictions or decisions. And these layers are all doing very simple operations. They're just doing what's called a linear operation and then a simple thing called a pointwise nonlinearity. It's just this linear, pointwise, nonlinear, linear, pointwise, nonlinear. So these are very simple mathematical objects, but they can do amazing things when they learn from data. And what kinds of representations do deep nets learn? Well, they learn to somehow organize the data in a way that makes it easy to solve the task of interest, which might be to make a prediction about the data, to classify the data, or to make a decision on the basis of what the network is seeing. Okay, so let's go to the next question. How did your research in image-to-image translation shape your current work? Okay, this is taking me back a little ways, but back during my postdoc about 7 or 8 years ago, I worked on this problem called image-to-image translation, which is to try to take an image that is presented in one kind of style or modality, like a color image, and predict what it would look like viewed a different way. For example, translate a photo into a sketch, or translate a sketch into a photo, or maybe take a photo and try to say, what would it look like if some artist, Cezanne, had painted that scene? So you can kind of visualize the world in different ways, and we called this a translation problem, translating from one visual format to another one. So this project was really fun, it was popular, and it definitely affected my thinking and my ongoing thinking about AI. To take you back, in the era before we did that work, there were a lot of special purpose ways of solving problems in computer vision. So if you wanted to solve a problem like object detection, try to label all the objects in a photo, you would use a fairly different method than if you wanted to solve a problem like estimating the depth of all the objects in the photo, like predicting what's called a depth map. So that didn't really satisfy me. I really wanted something that would be a more uniform, unified solution to all those problems, because what we kind of realized is that all of these different computer vision problems could be thought of as taking some set of pixels as input and predicting some other set of pixels as output. So the output pixels could represent where the objects are, or they could visualize the depth map of the scene. So these were all pixel-to-pixel problems, and that led to us calling this project Pix-to-Pix. That was the name we gave it, pixels-to-pixels. Essentially, we had a more general-purpose framework for solving all of those problems rather than having specialized solutions for each one. And that made me realize, essentially, how powerful a more general-purpose and unified solution can be. And really, the big trend over the last, you know, 5 or 10 years of AI has been toward these general-purpose solutions. The biggest phase of that now is with these large language models, where one big model is trained to do a lot of different tasks. So when you interact with a chatbot or a language model, you can ask it all kinds of questions. You can even ask it to make an image or to solve a math problem. And it's one model that with a kind of generic framework is able to solve all those problems. So I think that's an interesting trend, and that's what I'm always kind of on the outlook for right now. Simple unifying principles and methods that can be applied to a wide variety of problems. Any recommendations for the best AI image generation models? Okay. One I really like right now is called Stable Diffusion. I like this model because it's open source, so we get to use it and intervene on it and really study it as scientists. And it's one of the image generation models that works well. So my lab mostly uses Stable Diffusion in our research as the current model. Another one that I like a lot is called ControlNet. ControlNet is kind of the current most popular iteration of image-to-image translation. We did old work like Pix-to-Pix, And now people have gone way beyond that, and ControlNet is the latest. So what it does is it allows you to condition your generative model on an image and produce another image. For example, you can take a sketch and you can turn that sketch into a photo. So ControlNet, Stable Diffusion, these are some of the fun ones that I'm playing with now.